all in Lord Jesus Christ. I am Princy Paul talking to you from Dallas in Texas, and I am delighted to warmly welcome you all to the third series of our virtual symposium of this month entitled Studies on the Accord Theological Tradition of the Orthodox Church in line with the UN World Environment Day 2021. Let me begin by citing a beautiful verse wherein King David profoundly expresses the divine relevance of the universe, the manifestation of God in the universe. Psalm 19 verse 1 quotes, "The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they display knowledge. There is no speech or language where their voice is not heard." This month, as we celebrate the World Environment Day with the United Nations echoing the need to counteract climate change and stop the collapse of our biodiversity, URHO has taken an important step in raising awareness among the members of the church about the need to contribute towards the betterment of the environment around us. As the world reels under the effects of environmental pollution, wildlife extinction, and global warming, and world leaders are pondering on how to improve the healthy ecosystems and enhance people's livelihood, it is high time that we as members of the church play a vital role for the conservation of our surroundings. For this, we hope a better understanding of how the theological traditions of our church relate to ecology will open the eyes of our believers regarding the importance our church lays on ecological preservation. It is a duty imbibed in us by God our Creator and reminded to us by our church through our holy liturgy and holy sacraments. So to throw more light on this topic, today we have with us an eminent scholar and a metropolitan who did his PhD on eco-theology from the University of Kent, England, BD from the United Theological College, served as a faculty at Malankara Syrian Orthodox Theological Seminary, who is actively involved in ecumenical endeavors and currently serves as the moderator of the Commission on World Mission and Evangelism, and is the president of Kerala Council of Churches. In addition to his pastoral duties, the speaker is a distinguished author of various publications, including Green Liberation Towards an Integral Accord Theology. Let me now welcome the Metropolitan of Nirinam Diocese of the Syriac Orthodox Church, His Eminence Morkourlos Givargis, to this virtual platform. Your Grace, the stage is now yours, please. Welcome, Tirumin.
Spirit. Amen. Thank you, Dr. Princy Paul, for those kind words.
My pleasure.
At the very outset, I would like to express my deep sense of gratitude to the organizers of this symposium, to the HiMonitor team for having organized such an important series of webinars on a very important concern that we are all concerned about, particularly during these times. I also want to thank my dear friend Binto Paul for personally inviting me to be part of this initiative. In fact, Binto has been chasing me for a long time, but for various reasons, I could not make it earlier than this. But I'm very happy that I'm part of this very important initiative that HiMonitor has taken up within our church. In fact, when I was doing my PhD studies way back in the 1990s, it was not very fashionable to talk about ecological issues. Even among progressive circles that I was part of, even those who followed the Latin American liberation theology, they were not convinced about ecological issues. The general perception during those days was that it was too elitistic to talk about the environment. The issue was a Western issue for most of us then. So progressive circles thought it was a luxury to indulge in theological reflections on the environment, when we had other issues like more pressing issues like poverty, unemployment, and so on. But as a student of liberation theology, even those days, I was really convinced that liberation theology could not go on ignoring the ecological issues. And I was heavily influenced by people like Father Sebastian Carpen, Dr. K.C. Abraham, and others, who persuaded me to take up this issue from a liberation perspective. And I was all the more convinced that the issues of socioeconomic justice, like poverty, and the issues of ecological justice were integrally interrelated. And that was my burden for my PhD studies. When I came up with a green version of liberation theology, people slowly began to take it seriously. I'm happy that things have moved on. And today there is much greater awareness, much stronger commitment to this issue of environmental justice. And I hope that this webinar, or the series of webinars that Haimanutho is organizing, will have an impact on each and every one of us to take this ecological issue seriously, and that this will persuade us to respond to this challenge from a Christian, particularly from an Orthodox theological perspective. So with these words of prologue, may I straight away go to the subject of this evening's reflections. Can we have the next slide, please, and see? I want to begin by quoting an extract from the Ecumenical Patriarch Bartholomew, who is popularly known as the Green Patriarch. This is what he says in this particular writing. And I quote, "For us Orthodox, every destruction of the natural environment caused by humanity constitutes an offense against the Creator himself or herself and ourselves, and arouses a deep sense of sorrow in relation to the degree in which people are responsible for their action. Metanoia, a radical change, of course, is demanded. And for this reason, each human act that contributes to the destruction of the natural environment must be regarded as a serious sin," unquote. To me, this extract captures the soul and spirit of what Orthodox theology has to offer, has to say about ecological integrity. The fact that the Patriarch calls human intervention with nature that destroys the ecological balance a serious sin is particularly striking. And the Patriarch also calls for repentance, metanoia on our part, for the kind of destruction that we have caused to the environment. We need to be repentant about. We need to be thinking about our attitude towards the environment. I was just reminded of an environmental issue that Kerala is talking about these days. But how much of an impact the church has made in this whole debate? I'm talking about a massive tree felling that has happened in Kerala. But the church is not talking about it, as if it is an issue for the politicians to sort out. For me, it is an issue of justice. It is an issue of integrity of creation, where churches should be raising their voice. But I hardly hear any voice from the side of the church. We don't consider this a sin, and therefore we don't repent. And I hope our reflections this evening and the whole series of webinars would challenge us to take a different perspective on what is happening around us, a different perspective on the ecological, the environmental issues, and then take a serious stance on them. Let's hope and pray that this series of webinars will challenge us in that direction. So with this introduction, let us reflect on some of the orthodox theological insights that I believe have the potential to address the contemporary ecological issues seriously. Next slide, please. Let's start with the concept of God in Orthodox theology. How is the divine comprehended, understood in Orthodox theology? As we know, Orthodox theology is basically apophatic theology. It simply means that we begin with the submission that human reason cannot comprehend the reality of God fully, that our language has constraints and limitations to grasp the reality of God fully. And within those limitations of language, we believe in Orthodox theology that the best possible language to talk about God is the language of the Holy Trinity. And that is why the concept of the Holy Trinity is very much central to Orthodox theology. And the concept of the Holy Trinity offers so much wisdom for us to look at the ecological issues around us. The Holy Trinity, as we know, is basically about interconnectedness. So is ecology. Ecology is about the web of relationships. It is about interrelatedness of beings. It is about perichoresis, mutual indwelling within a family. The Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit are interrelated. They live in a communion. They are interdependent. Likewise, God, creation, and humanity, they are also in a relationship of interdependence. And that is what ecology is all about. So the fact that the Orthodox theology moves around the concept of Holy Trinity offers us basically an ecological perspective. Ecology, as we know, is precisely about this interconnectedness between us, nature, and God. The Holy Trinity also offers a vision of God which helps us transcend anthropocentrism, which actually is one of the root causes of the ecological crisis that we face today. The sense of human-centeredness is overcome within this perspective of the Holy Trinity. Trinity can also overcome the tendency of dualism. It can also overcome the exclusive tendencies, androcentric tendencies. It is basically an egalitarian system. What characterizes the Holy Trinity are the values of justice, equality, interrelatedness, sharing, love. And this perspective of the Holy Trinity, therefore, is very helpful in addressing the issues of ecology, because ecology is basically about interconnectedness. And when Holy Trinity is about justice, interconnectedness, sharing, mutuality, inclusiveness, then Trinity probably is the best perspective that we can think of to talk about ecological issues and also to respond to those challenges. Let me move on to the next slide. When we talk about the Trinitarian aspect of Godhead, It is also related to the concept of life in Orthodox theology. Our understanding of life is an integral, a holistic one. We consider basically life as a gift of God. And when we talk about life, it includes all aspects of life, all forms of life. We don't discriminate between various aspects and various dimensions of life. For example, between the physical life or the biological life and the eternal life or the eschatological dimension of life. So the tendency to glorify one of them, the tendency to glorify the eternal aspects of life or eternal life at the expense of the biological, physical life, is a temptation that the Orthodox theology resists, because all aspects of life is a gift of God. Therefore, every aspect of life is sacred within the Orthodox theology. This has ethical and mission implications. If all aspects, all dimensions of life is sacred, then we have a responsibility to take care of all life, not just human life. The failure to recognize this interconnectedness, the human, the non-human, social, biological, eternal, eschatological, all these aspects of life are interconnected. It is our failure to recognize this interconnectedness is at the heart of the ecological crisis. Therefore, we need to take the Orthodox understanding of life seriously here. Life in all its dimensions is taken seriously in Orthodoxy. So there is no discrimination between what we call physical life and eternal life. We take them all equally seriously. And this has implications for our understanding of creation and our responsibility towards nature, the environment around us. Next slide. What is our understanding of the whole world, the cosmos? What is our cosmology in our Orthodox understanding? I think this is important for us to consider the ecological issues. In our understanding, creation reflects the Holy Triune God. Creation is a mirror of the Creator. Saint John of Damascus calls the entire world as a single icon of God. It's an icon of God and it reflects the Creator. In other words, what we have in Orthodoxy is a panentheistic understanding of the world. It is different from pantheism. We don't consider God, we don't identify God with the creation ontologically. Panentheism is about beholding, encountering God in creation. God in creation. Irenaeus, for example, tells us that God includes the fullness of all things, ta panta in Greek. God includes a pleroma of every creation. In other words, God is in creation. And this is radically different from the Neo-Orthodoxy theology, where God is seen as the holy other, with no relationship with creation. In Orthodox theology, everything that exists does so in God, in relation to God. When we come to the Cappadocian Fathers, for example, they rejected Gnosticism and affirmed matter. For the Gnostics, matter was essentially evil. But Cappadocian Fathers affirmed matter, because they believe that God chose to assume matter to redeem the whole creation. Matter was the medium of God's incarnation in Christ. in Genesis 1:1, the very opening words of the Bible, we see this element of panentheism. God is beheld in creation, in waters. The Spirit of God was brooding over the waters. So you see God, you experience God in waters, in God's creation. So mission can be understood as God's turning towards creation. Next slide. What is distinct about Orthodox theology of mission is that creation has an agency in God's mission. Quite often we think that only human beings are God's missionaries. No, that's not true. In our theology, creation is also accorded agency of God's mission. We have this concept of synergy, for example, which holds that God uses humanity for God's mission, as God's agents. But this understanding of synergy is not limited to humanity. It is extended to the whole creation. The whole creation joins in God's mission. For example, in our tradition, the use of nature, the various elements of nature in our sacraments and in our liturgy is an expression of this agency of creation that we see in God's mission. It helps us to overcome what we call human-centeredness, anthropocentrism. Elizabeth Theokritov, I'm glad that she's going to talk to us in the next seminar. She calls creation God's missionaries, God's mission team. And she talks about Acts chapter 1, verse 8, where Jesus calls his disciples God's witnesses. And then again tells us that there were witnesses even before the so-called disciples. And that was a reference about Acts 14, where the word of God talks about creation in general, rain from heaven, fruitful season. They were all witnesses to God's mission. And this is why St. Maximus the Confessor called the created world God's witnesses. So it is not just humanity that is partaking in God's mission as God's agents, but the whole creation of God partake in God's mission as co-missionaries. Next slide. Let's come to the whole question of anthropology, which I think is very critical for any discussion on environmental theology. The Orthodox theological anthropology is very distinct. The place of humanity in relation to God and creation in our thinking, in the Orthodox theological thinking, is profoundly articulated. And it has profound theological and ethical implications. Church fathers call humanity a microcosm, very much an integral part of nature. Saint Basil, for example, in his homilies on Hexameron, his commentary on the 6 days of God's creation recorded in the book of Genesis. And in that commentary, Saint Basil talks about the integrity of creation based on Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 to 26. He teaches us that in God's design, both heaven and earth have equal worth. Both heaven and earth are of equal worth and attention, because both of them, both heaven and earth, have the same origin in the same God. Therefore, there is no sense of hierarchy or discrimination between them. Both are worthy of equal attention and concern. Again, a mission concern. St. Maximus the Confessor calls humanity a mediator, an intermediary between God and creation. That is how humanity is poised between God and creation. He even calls humanity priests of creation. We are supposed to be taking the role of priests, clergy, in taking care of the integrity of creation. We are supposed to be serving the cause of creation. So mission for humanity is to bring creation into union with the Creator, with God. Next slide. A related issue when we talk about anthropology is the whole issue of the tension between what we call mastery and mystery, or the question of human dominion. And we all know that it's a bone of contention. It has been a vexed issue in theological debates. We are aware of the groundbreaking critique Lynn White brought when he said one of the fundamental root causes of ecological crisis today is the Judeo-Christian concept of creation recorded in the book of Genesis, where he argues that the concept of dominion that God is supposed to be giving to humanity after creation had an influential role in creating the mess that we talk about, the ecological crisis. The anthropocentric perspective on human dominion. When God had created everything, God gave humanity a certain dominion to rule over the rest of creation, which is called dominion. And Lynn White argued that this was one of the root causes of the environmental crisis worldwide. Of course, since then, there have been various responses, theological responses, in answering that critique. And one of the answers to this critique was the development of the concept of stewardship. But then, as I argue here, in the Orthodox theology, stewardship is not considered to be an effective answer to this critique. People like Paulus Mar Gregorius, for example, have argued that stewardship is still an anthropocentric concept. It's a managerial concept where humanity still retains a superiority complex. So that doesn't take us far enough. It is in that context some of us have reflected on this whole idea of kenosis. And in my work, I have come up with this idea of this whole notion of kenotic anthropocentrism, where we don't negate the idea of dominion that is implicit in the Genesis account of creation. It is a given. But the argument here is that although we are given the dominion at the time of creation, we are expected to exercise it the way Jesus exercised his dominion. And that is in the spirit of self-emptying, as we read in the letter of Philippians chapter 2. Although Jesus had authority and dominion, he chose to self-empty them, empty themselves off, and then took the form of servant for the sake of the whole creation. It is precisely that kenotic spirit that we need to imbibe. Although we have been given this sense of dominion, we are called to give up voluntarily this dominion for the sake of the whole creation and to be at the service of the environment, service of creation. That, I think, is a serious challenge before us as an Orthodox theological community. Next slide. We have this concept of mission in Orthodox theology, mission as earthly ascesis. Our world of sacraments and liturgy have so much to offer on this very important issue. As we have already seen, Orthodoxy looks at the whole world as a mysterious sacrament. Our icons, for example, of course, icons are not very popular in the Oriental tradition, but in the Eastern tradition icons are very, they assume a very important place. The icons are supposed to be representing the microcosm of the whole world. The use of water, incense, and other aspects of nature add a natural flavor to our worship and sacraments. Our understanding of the whole process of incarnation, for example, is that in Christ, God has actually become earth. Christ has become an earthling. Therefore, matter matters. And church is supposed to be an extension of this act of incarnation. And this is what St. John of Damascus conveys when he says, and I quote, "I shall not cease reverencing matter by means of which salvation has been achieved." The importance of matter in God's act of salvation is something Orthodoxy feels proud of. Elements that are pictured in icons, for example, again represents the microcosm. Look at our liturgies. Liturgy that we use on Palm Sunday, the Pentecost. They are full of nature. We use nature, various elements of nature in our liturgy. Water, for example. These things we need to take seriously. We should not confine them to the world of liturgy and sacraments. We need to take them to our real life. Elizabeth Theocritus, while talking about the Holy Eucharist, tells us that the bread that we use in the Eucharist is the same bread that we use that sustains our daily life. Same for the wine. So every aspect of creation has a crucial role in God's scheme of salvation. Look at the harvest festivals. These are the Orthodox way of celebrating nature, celebrating God's creation. Here we as the worshiping community offer back to God what God has given through creation. And this is what Saint Chrysostom says, thine own we offer unto thee. Look at the bond that we have with nature, and that is precisely what we celebrate in our harvest festivals. The Eucharist, which is supposed to be the ultimate expression of Orthodox theology and ethos, is about holding an organic life ethos. Irenaeus says, and I quote, "The Eucharist is not simply a memorial of Christ's death and resurrection, but a cosmic event, including the whole creation, bread, wine, and so on." So the Eucharist, which is the ultimate expression of God's saving act, is an organic act. It is not simply a memorial of God's death and resurrection in Christ, but it is a celebration of the whole creation. When God wants to offer himself or herself, God offers creation to us. When Jesus raises a loaf of bread in his hands and declares, "This is my body," he's actually making a powerful theological statement that God is actually in creation. God is present within creation. If God is present in creation, then we need to take creation seriously. If not, we are violating the image of God, the presence of God that is inherent, that is implicit in creation. Next slide, please. I once already talked about ascesis, the Orthodox sense of spirituality. You know, there are two modes, at least two modes of mission. The being mode and the becoming mode. We can do mission through our activities, through our projects, through what we do in actual terms. But we can also do mission by being. By being an Orthodox community. By following a certain spiritual discipline. For example, monastic tradition or the ascetic tradition is very important. They have a central place in orthodoxy. Although I must add that the tradition of monasticism and asceticism is slowly dying. I think we need to do something seriously to revive it. What is distinct about monastic and ascetic traditions within the Orthodox tradition is that it promotes an organic spirituality, which has the potential to counter or offer an alternative lifestyle in a context of globalization that promotes a culture of consumerism, for example. I consume, therefore I am, seems to be the dictum by which we live our lives today. The culture of consumerism. Consumption is what we go after these days. Whereas in the monastic ascetic tradition within the Orthodox worldview, we have an alternative vision, an alternative lifestyle that we can offer. Father Alexander talks about sin in terms of, he talks about fall from being a communicant to a consumer. We are supposed to be communicants in God's communion. But we have gone away, moved away from that role as communicants, and we have become basically consumers. I think there is a lot of misconception about the Orthodox emphasis on asceticism. There are traditions who think that ascetic lifestyles are a kind of escapism, that we run away from the world, which is not true. Actually, the ascetic movement, the monastic movement, is a counter-cultural movement which offers an alternative lifestyle. Our lens and our fasting, these are expressions of an alternative vision of life, contrary to a consumerist, market-oriented, globalized worldview. And these are values that we need to take seriously. And just to conclude my presentation, I think in the interest of time, I'll leave the conclusion in the next slide for you to read, which is basically a summary of what I have been saying so far. I have given some quotations from St. Chrysostom, Irenaeus, Metropolitan Gennadius. You can read them. They are on the screen. The next one is the concluding bit, which is basically a summary of what I have said so far. Let me pause there and take up questions or comments if you have any.
There are many. I think we have wonderfully covered the topic. First of all, let me thank you for beautifully explaining every aspect of this topic. So as I have read somewhere about Aristotle's triangle of persuading an audience using an ethos, pathos, and logos, I think we have covered all the aspects. You have covered it in an ethical way, logical way, as well as touching us in an emotional way. In all aspects, we have understood the importance. So now we may have some questions from the audience regarding how to carry out this thing in a practical way in our church. So there is one question. Thirumeni, what does the saying of Metropolitan John of Pergamon mean when he says, bringing creation into union with the divine?
This is about the cosmotheandric vision that I was talking about. In the Orthodox understanding, there is perfect union between God, Theos, Cosmos, the world, and Andros, or Anthropos, humanity. So it is this integral interrelatedness between God, creation, and humanity that makes Orthodox cosmology, Orthodox understanding of the divine, and the Orthodox understanding of the human a complete, a holistic one. But due to our sinful nature, because we have not taken this theological vision seriously, because of other influences as well, we have somehow managed to distance ourselves both from the Creator, from God, and also from the rest of creation. We have developed that gap, which wasn't there at the time of creation, between us, between God and us, God and humanity, and between us and the non-human creation. So what Metropolitan John of Pergamon is challenging us here is that we as intermediaries between God and creation, or we as priests of creation, as we have already heard, have the task of reconciling ourselves both with the Creator God and also with the rest of creation. That is mission in terms of reconciliation of the whole creation. And humanity has a particular task here. Again, there is a comparison or a contrast made between humanity and angels in Orthodox theology. Angels are a special creation. Unlike humanity, unlike human beings, they don't have matter as a basic stuff among the angels. Angels are not created out of matter, whereas humanity is made out of matter. Matter, earth, is the stuff that we are made of. Because we are earthly creation, because matter is part of the very being of our entity, we have a special responsibility to bring reconciliation between God and creation. And this is what Metropolitan John is asking us to do, challenging us to take seriously.
Thank you, Tharmini. So we discussed about the cosmotheandric vision, so in which there is a harmonious relationship between God and human and non-human creation. So how far are our holy sacraments and holy liturgy taking a step in this direction to preserve the cosmos in our church?
As I've been trying to say in my presentation, we have very profound, lofty theology, especially our theology of sacraments, liturgy, and all that, unmatchable almost. But our basic problem is that we also have a beautiful concept of liturgy after liturgy. But the problem is that we take liturgy seriously, at least some of us, but we don't take liturgy after liturgy seriously. There is this huge mismatch between what we talk and what we live out. This is what I have been trying to talk about, the being mode of church. The being mode of mission is equally important as the becoming mode of mission. Unless we walk the talk, I think we will not have the credibility to claim our orthodoxy. As I said, our theology is powerful. It is one of the most relevant theologies of our times. But somehow, as I gave you some examples from our liturgy, look at our Palm Sunday liturgy, for example. It's full of nature. It's a celebration of nature. And we use palm leaves. We use water in the liturgy of the Pentecost. All these are biblical foundations. The whole Bible, right from Genesis all the way up to the book of Revelation, talks about nature and God's place in God's scheme. But then we leave it there at the level of liturgy and sacraments. Just to give you an example, how many of us have heard about a sermon on a Palm Sunday, which had to do with ecological issues? How many of our clergy talk about ecological issues in their sermons on Sundays? John 6, for example, the story of Jesus feeding the 5,000 people. We have heard hundreds of sermons on that text. But how many sermons have we heard about this text, which brought some ecological dimensions out of it? The fact that God in Christ did not waste a single loaf of bread at the end. You know, when there was something left over, it was collected. And if you know the biblical tradition, it was collected for the sake of the poor. But how do we live our lives in a consumerist society? How do we manage our waste, so-called waste? But when we talk about feeding the 5,000, you know, it doesn't come to our mind. So there was an ecological sensitivity that Jesus wanted us to have in every single act he did. So I think we have so much to offer in terms of theology, but we have so little that we do in approximating those theology into our actual life. This is a serious challenge. Or just to give you another example, Jesus turning water into wine at Cana. A very familiar story. But one of the church fathers, the way he interprets that event, that act, in just one simple but profound sentence, when creation encountered the Creator, it simply transformed. Water simply transformed. So that is the power of the Creator God. When God encounters creation, it's a transforming encounter. And this is precisely what God expects humanity to be doing in our mission work as well. When we encounter, when we deal with nature, what God expects of us is transformation of ourselves and of nature. But what we do in actual life is destroying nature, the very opposite of God's intention.
Thank you, Tarmini. And like you said, we are supposed to walk the talk. So I think we are having a lot of questions on what practical changes can be done and what the church can do to bring about green initiatives. Like you mentioned the kenosis, right? Green stewards, which is a bit, maybe not a concept which is maybe arguable, but as we take it to move on to being a communicant from a consumerist attitude. Right, that's what you mentioned. So I think everyone wants to know what can be done on a practical level from the church to implement, like how you said, walking the talk or making people more aware about it.
I think it's something that we need to collectively reflect on, and I can offer some pointers, but then I think it's up to us. We are the church, not just bishops. I think we need to come up with new ideas. There are things that are happening in different churches, but I think on the implementation part, our church is kind of behind compared to other churches. How many of our churches observe an ecological Sunday, for example, when most of the other sister churches have? Every year there is one Sunday dedicated for the environment, for the ecology. But I don't think we are serious about it. So much can be done, I think, from our home churches, from our Sunday school level, from our youth gatherings. You know, we can discuss all these issues and come up with ideas. Clergy have a particular role, as I said, you know, they need to bring these issues through their sermons. They, you know, they have a responsibility to educate the church. And sermons are the best ways to do that. But I don't know how many of our clergy are serious about it. small little things like you know, developing a garden in our churchyard, or taking care of the graveyards, for example, giving up certain things that we are used to. We have fellowship dinners or fellowship gatherings, meals and things like that, you know. I think we are a consumerist society when it comes to dining and things like that, you know. Can we bring in some change there? It might be giving up Coca-Cola, for example. I mean, I'm using, you would have seen what Ronaldo did during one of the press conferences. It had a huge impact, you know. A simple act of removing a Coca-Cola can from the table that he was sitting, it had a huge impact. I stopped consuming cola products some 30 years ago as an ideological commitment, because I was part of a struggle in Kerala, a struggle against Coca-Cola in Kerala, Lachimada. Because when I learned about the whole struggle, I was convinced that this multinational company was exploiting the natural resources, particularly water, from our land for its corporate profit interest. So I took a decision to give up Coca-Cola products, and I've been following that for the last 30 odd years. I'm still alive. These are small little things that we can do individually, but we can also do things collectively. There are political things that we can do. My own involvement in the Chengara land struggle in Kerala. Of course, some people criticize me for taking active role in what they call political movements and things like that. But then for me, it was not a political act in the narrow sense of the term. For me, it was a theological commitment. For me, it was a faith-driven initiative that I took. I was convinced that the Chengara struggle was a struggle for land rights. Ecology is about land rights as well. I could see the Jubilee principle that we read in Leviticus chapter 25. Applied there in Chengara. When I see people living in Chengara, my sense of ecological justice gets reinforced. It is in Chengara struggle front that I see a community living in harmony with nature. So these are some of the initiatives, some of the things that we can do at the level of personal lifestyles, at ecclesial level, what churches can do, at the parish level, for example, the decision to not to use plastic cups, for example. These are simple things, but then we don't take them seriously.
Definitely, Thirumayne. I personally appreciate all those steps. Even you mentioned the felling of trees, how yes. much, you know, little the voices were raised against that. So these are some things that I think more people should stand up for. And like we had the discussion today,
it's okay to keep quiet, you know, that I can understand coming from our conservative theological ecclesial tradition. But then, you know, what I cannot understand is that those voices that are heard, people who want to make voice, they are being repressed. You know, they are isolated, their voices are suppressed. You know, this is what I don't understand. You know, if they want to keep a convenient silence about certain issues, that is up to them. But if there are people who are wanting to raise voice against injustice, why should church suppress those voices? You know, it's against the biblical spiritualities, against the orthodox theological principles. You know, that is where I find myself disappointed with our ecclesial traditions. You know, we think that, you know, taking up social issues, joining political struggles, etc., are not part of theological tradition. It is against what we call spirituality, which is completely wrong. In fact, to the contrary, Orthodox theology is deeply political. It's very radical. If you're serious about Trinity, it is all about politics, all about justice. It's all about egalitarianism. It is about change. But then, as I said, you know, we don't take the implications of our theology seriously. We don't want to translate them into actual life. We don't want to practice them in our actual life. That is where I have problem with our orthodoxy, not with our theology so much, but the way we betray our theology.
So, Thirumeni, we also believe our redemption is cosmic in nature. At this time, I just thought I would ask you that. It's not limited to humankind.
No,
but the whole universe.
No, when we talk about cosmotheantric vision, it implies that our understanding of salvation is a cosmic one. And this is what we read in Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 8. The whole creation is yearning for God's revelation, for salvation, not just human beings. So God's plan, scheme of salvation includes the entire creation, not just human beings. And that is being affirmed in Orthodox theology. As I have tried to articulate in my presentation, matter matters in Orthodox theology. Mm-hmm. Unlike the dualistic Gnostic thinking, you know, we have an integral vision of life. You know, we don't segregate between physical life and eternal life, between heaven and earth, between this world and the other world to come, between humanity and non-human creation. So the whole world is going to be saved. It is cosmic salvation that Orthodox theology talks about and teaches. And therefore, we cannot be saved in isolation. Our salvation is going to be dependent on the salvation of this world. The preservation of this environment is crucial, therefore.
So such concepts can be introduced to the church at an earlier stage, like, because now we had the environment day going on, we had a discussion. What if it's incorporated in our Sunday school lessons or, you know, from a young age, so that otherwise this concept will be new. Once in a while, if you listen to it, if those who listen to it, they are aware of this. Otherwise, we are in a general concept that salvation is for mankind. That's how somehow it is imbibed in us. So would you think that many such, you know, making such things common knowledge in our churches will help us go a long way? I think then people will stop separating politics from church, or just working for the society as something different from being in church.
Yeah. Absolutely, I agree with you. We need to take some deliberate measures, purposefully, right from Sunday school onwards. I think we need to. I haven't reflected seriously on our Sunday school syllabus, but maybe we can do something there to integrate some of these perspectives, Orthodox theological perspectives on the whole creation. So right from Sunday school classes onwards, you know, our children are taught our creation theology in the right perspective. I think we also need to train our clergy. Of course, these things are taught in seminaries, but the problem is that, you know, once they leave the four walls of the seminary, they become a different species. This has been my experience with even some of my students. You know, within the seminary campus, you know, they are some of the most progressive, radical students and theologians, you know, even more revolutionary than Karl Marx himself. But once they have their degrees in their pocket, once they join the ministry, you know, they transform themselves completely into a different species. They could care less about what they have learned. I know that there are exceptions, but I'm talking about, you know, things in general. Majority of our clergy, who are even theologically trained clergy, you know, they completely choose to ignore what they have learned in theological seminaries, thinking that it is purely academic and had nothing to do with their lives or ministry. And they confine themselves to the you know, traditional structures of the church, for various reasons, of course. You know, maybe some of them are scared of the bishops, I don't know. So, but I think they need to be intellectually honest to themselves. If they were convinced about their theology when they learned them, they need to bring them home, and they need to articulate them in a language that people can understand without compromising the integrity of the gospel. So the social, ecological, the gender perspective, for example, the ecological perspective, justice perspective, all these perspectives on the scripture, on our faith, need to be communicated to our people. Sermons is one of them, Sunday school is another, media, youth association gatherings. We can teach, we can educate our youth, young people on some of these issues. So it's not just about learning Syriac and Syriac songs and things like that. They are important. We also need to invest time and energy on educating our people, our clergy, our youth, about our theological wealth of resources. What Orthodox theology has to offer on the environmental challenges. What does it say about social justice, for example, economic justice, for that matter? You know, how can Orthodoxy address Black Lives Matter, for that matter? But these are issues that we need to be concerned about. And there is, within Orthodox theology, so much of theological resources that can address these issues, but they are hardly used.
Thank you, Tirumeni. So I think this talk has really opened our eyes onto how much importance actually our theology lays on ecology. Even every Sunday as we celebrate Mass, as we see the priest holding the bread and wine, it should come into our mind as to this, that creation, all of creation, is relevant in our lives. So I think this is a very big reminder for us, and it's a call for us to take care of our surroundings. As much importance as we give to our own bodies, to our own humankind, the equal importance given to everything. So this has really been an eye-opener for me, and I'm sure for everybody else. Thank you so much, Tirumeni, for spending so much time for us. It's indeed an honor to have you here and discuss so many issues with us and to explain so many important aspects of this very difficult concept and very important concept as well.
My pleasure. Thank you. Thank you for having me. I'm grateful to the organizing team for having invited me to be part of this important initiative. Thank you, Dr. Quincy Paul, for sharing this session. You've done a great job. And thank you all for your questions and comments. And I hope this conversation can continue, and that we will take up ecological environmental issues seriously, not just as a matter of political intervention or as an issue of socio-economic justice, but as a faith issue, as an issue of faith. As the Orthodox community, we need to take them seriously. I think it's part of our mission, as we have heard from the presentation. God expects us to be intermediaries between God's self and creation. And that is how we are poised between God and creation. We need to take up that role seriously as the priests, clergy of creation, as we have heard the whole kenotic understanding of humanity. Although we've been given dominion at the time of creation, we are called to exercise the dominion in the way Jesus would exercise his sense of dominion by giving it up completely for the sake of us, for the sake of the entire creation. So the challenge for us is to be at the service of creation for the sake of all of us, for the sake of the entire world. So once again, thank you for giving me this honor, for having me. I hope it has been a useful exercise for all of us.
Yes.
And that we will continue to be motivated through such interactions. And I wish Haimanutho all God's blessings as he continue this journey ahead. God bless.
Thank you, Tehmin.
Thank you.